you, like, by kind of laying out what happens with the Apple chips, it makes it clearer that even if China wanted to grow its own semiconductor industry, it's going to be pretty tough for them to, can they actually do everything domestically, or would they still have to rely on Japan and Europe and all these other places?
If you're looking at advanced technology, I think there's no way in the foreseeable future China can do it all domestically. It's just too expensive, too complicated. No other country can do it. No other country has really tried. If you're looking at more low-tech chips, there's more of a chance that you can do it domestically. Still probably impossible to do it all domestically, but you can at least reduce your reliance on foreign suppliers. And in particular, you can reduce your reliance on choke points that are controlled by just one supplier. And that's what China's really focused on right now. And so if you trace the dollars that China is spending on its chip industry, a lot of them are actually going towards less technologically advanced chips, where there's more of a chance that China can produce them without being reliant on one supplier, and in particular, a single American supplier that could be used to cut off its access to the technology that it needs.
So these low-tech chips are, like, maybe you can't use them in cruise missiles, but they're maybe the equivalent of those big bullets in Mario Brothers?
Well, yeah, there's, even in an iPhone, the key processor is produced with among the most advanced semiconductor technologies in the world, but a lot of processors in various devices don't require the most advanced processing. And so whether it's automobiles or consumer goods, there's a lot of low-tech chips we need and we use, but that don't require the cutting edge. And so that's where China's investing. And by the next decade, it's going to play a major role in the production of these types of chips.
What is the thinking behind investing in some of these lower-tech chips? Like, what do they want to get out of it?
Well, I think answering that question depends on who you're looking at in China. I think there's people in the chip industry who have business goals. I think there's people in the government who often have more political goals in mind. And trying to assess how these different groups interact is always difficult. If you look at the Chinese government, there's been a real focus on providing security of supply in case of foreign cutoffs. And that's what the political leadership, I think, is focused on. But a lot of chip executives in China, they're focused on building viable businesses, and they realize that they're not going to be able to succeed at making a profitable business if they're taking on existing firms in Taiwan or South Korea that already dominate their markets. And so it's often these firms that are trying to carve out niches with lower end technology where they think they've got a cost advantage or some other market advantage that will give them an edge. And this interaction between the political goals and the corporate leadership themselves is what makes China's chip industry so complicated and to be honest, difficult to make sense of, because you do have so many different actors with so many different goals playing a role.
Are all of these chip manufacturers being supported with funding from the Chinese government?
Most of them are, especially when you look at the large publicly traded Chinese chip firms. The Chinese government, both national and provincial level, has invested pretty widely across the Chinese chip industry.
Well, the Chinese Communist Party has pretty much given a government mandate to pushing advanced technology with the Made in China 2025 program. Semiconductors are a huge part of that. So what I'm trying to understand is if semiconductors are such, you know, they require so many different players, and there's no real way for China in the near future to just be able to entirely make its own high quality semiconductors. Why is this a chip war? What's the threat of any of this?
I think there are two questions at play. One is there's a risk of a real war over Taiwan, which would be potentially intensified by the world's reliance on Taiwan for chips. So that's one aspect of this that is hopefully not, but potentially a real war. But in terms of the U.S.-China dynamic, the Chinese government has correctly realized that they're at risk of the U.S. cutting China off of crucial technologies for the future of the Chinese economy and also of defense systems. And the U.S. is committed to keeping China behind in these computing technologies. And so there's been an escalating set of restrictions and subsidies from Beijing and from Washington that are intended to shape the future of which countries' industry plays a bigger role in defining the computing technologies of the future. And whether it's Obama, Trump, or Biden in the U.S., there's been pretty consistent policies to keep China back. And for the last decade from Beijing, we've seen a consistent desire to increase China's footprint in the chip ecosystem with the aim of giving China more clarity, more security over the semiconductors that it needs for economic purposes, but also for military purposes.
Since China is so focused on increasing its semiconductor capacity, I guess why did the United States lose its edge?
Well, I think there's two ways to answer that question. The first is to say that the U.S. lost its edge in certain spheres, but not others, which is crucial to understanding the power dynamics here. It's certainly the case that Taiwan and its company TSMC is ahead of U.S. firms like Intel in terms of producing, manufacturing the most advanced chips. But we've also got to realize that TSMC is completely dependent on U.S. technology and its production processes. So there's interdependence between the U.S. and Taiwan based on what each of them does well. But in terms of why the U.S. fell behind in terms of manufacturing the most chips, it's largely because Intel, which used to be the leader in producing processor chips, fell behind TSMC. The story of one company really shapes the development of the industry over the last 10 years. And there's a chance that Intel finds a way to catch up to where TSMC is today. It's only a couple of years behind where TSMC is, and under a new CEO at Intel, Pat Gelsinger, they're investing very heavily trying to turn things around. But unless they do so, TSMC will likely remain ahead for the foreseeable future.
And so if China were to invade Taiwan, like, what do you think would happen? Would that just disrupt the global supply of semiconductors? Would this then give China the ability to produce the, you know, the highest quality, 90% of the market? Would they just blow up? Would the, you know, fleeing Taiwanese forces just blow up the factory so China can't get a hold of it?
Yeah, I think it's pretty implausible that China could ever take control of TSMC's facilities in Taiwan. If there was an actual war, you know, we're talking about the most precise machinery in use today. So very little of that would survive a war zone. And even if you got the machinery without any sort of damage, you need all the personnel in place and you need regular supplies of materials and software updates and other tools from Japan, the US, and elsewhere. So if there is a war, you'd have to assume that TSMC's facilities stop producing and the impact on the global economy would be dramatic. I think you'd struggle to produce a single smartphone around the world in the year after a attack on Taiwan. A large share of the chips that power PCs are produced in Taiwan. Data centers are crucially dependent on chips made in Taiwan. You basically can't have a cell phone tower without chips made in Taiwan. The number of industries that would face wrenching delays is extraordinary. I think it's quite plausible that an attack on Taiwan, just due to the semiconductor industry disruptions alone, would have more of an economic cost for the global economy than all of the disruptions of COVID, certainly in the trillions of dollars.
Well, and these disruptions would not only happen here in the U.S., they'd also be equally disruptive of China, right?
That's right. That's right. China is in some ways even more dependent on TSMC than the United States. It's not just that Chinese consumers want smartphones and PCs, but also that a lot of the goods into which TSMC's processors go are actually assembled in China. For example, iPhones are largely, but not exclusively, assembled in China. And so all of those assembly facilities and jobs would be at risk.